to take that challenging plunge into commitment. So did my husband and I. But every time, I have had one very good reason for saying yes to him. And it is this. I said, like every other girl, my father is my hero. He let me travel around the world. So tell me one place where my father cannot take me, but you can. And he, an ardent seafarer, quickly replied, I will take you to the bow of my ship. And he said, this is a Titanic pose. From there I will show you how the Pacific embraces the Atlantic. For an LLM student, that was pristine romance. And as the reels of romance gave away to the reality of marriage, I joined my husband on board a big, beautiful ship. We joined in Montreal and sailed through the Great Lakes of US and Canada, explored the countrysides of Australia, and the techno cities of Japan. With tasting of multiple cuisines, shopping in different countries, handsome earnings that were by somebody else, against the backdrop of a big, beautiful blue sea, I thought shipping was just tons of fun. But I still remember some of those experiences were just so much that I just could not understand that there could be anything other than happiness and fun when shipping comes in. I have a memory of one specific incident, which was Equator crossing. I don't know how many of you know, but Equator crossing ceremonies are big things when you are on a ship. It is a big thing in the sense that lunch is lavish. You have the sailors coming in dressed in fancy clothes, and the first-timers are always talked to and issued a certificate of having crossed the equator, which is welcoming them into the world of King Neptune, the Lord of the Seas. However, as I graduated in life from being just the wife of a marine engineer to also being a lawyer with considerable practice in shipping, I realized that with over 90% of the world trade happening through water transport, shipping is serious business. If it is serious business, so vital to the environment, trade, commerce, and employment, there ought to be multiple legal disputes connected with shipping. We have a number of cases in shipping, starting from cargo claims, charter party issues, freight, demurrage, piracy attacks, ship arrests, non-payment of seafarers' wages, etc. But in all this, I feel that what really makes or breaks a shipping case is the issue of jurisdiction. Now, jurisdiction has many shades to it. First, the forum, or which subject goes into which forum for adjudication. For example, you are a student, you failed in your exam, but you still want to party with your friends. You know very well, mother is your forum. Next, you are a 26-year-old female. In Indian context, your mother has registered you in almost all the matrimonial sites known, but you want to do your PhD abroad. Your father is the forum. This is called subject matter jurisdiction. Certain subjects can be entertained only in certain specific forums. Next, we have something called which plane that we can institute the case in. You have multiple options, but you should know cleverly where your case must go into. Example, you are a gang of 10 students. Your principal pulls you up for indiscipline. Each one of your class teachers had the option to recommend you to condone or pardon your indiscipline. Each one of you will think, I have multiple options, but I can go through the teacher which is the most dependable one. This is choice of jurisdiction or the issue of territorial jurisdiction. Correct case must go to the correct forum. We have also other issue of jurisdiction which is dependent on the amount of claim involved, which is called pecuniary jurisdiction. However, but of these, territorial jurisdiction is a shipping lawyer's googly. Territorial jurisdiction essentially refers to the territories over which, or the area within which, a court can exercise its authority or control so that the issue that is brought before the court can be decided by it, that is the right to entertain a dispute and the right or the authority to give a verdict or a judgment on a particular dispute. If there is no territorial jurisdiction, the court cannot pass a judgment. Even if it passes a judgment, that the judgment has no value because it cannot be implemented. Now, when we refer to territorial jurisdiction, what we need to understand is, how is territorial jurisdiction measured? Like you have kilometers for road transport measurement, you have a measurement called nautical miles when it comes to measurement of water. All nautical miles start with something called baseline. It is this baseline which is the low water mark on a coast of any coastal state. So like you have road maps when you use your bikes or cars and travel on the road, you have something called nautical charts which is followed by sailors when they go as seafarers. I said shipping is an international industry. Therefore, the laws governing shipping is also twofold. One, you have the laws at the international level, controlled primarily by the International Maritime Organization coming under the United Nations. You have resolutions, conventions, decisions which come from the international organ. Say, for example, we have CELES, which is safety of life at sea. We have MARPOL, and it's an excess for dealing with pollution. And then we have domestic laws with each country, on the basis of which the international instruments may be included within your domestic sphere. To put it simply, say assuming you are all living in a residential colony in different houses. The common law of the colony allows swimming pool to be used till 9 p.m. But in your house, you tell your children that they have to be inside by 7 p.m. The child protests, they say, nothing doing, colony rule is 9, more importantly, my neighbor says only 9, so why is it 7 here? You say, no, my house, my rule, I am the ruler, take it or leave it. Correct. Why? Because you can have an outer limit of 9, nothing beyond, but the inside limit is decided by you. It is your domestic space, your domestic jurisdiction. Like this, as far as shipping is concerned, nautical mile has been internationally accepted and domestically recognized by having a particular extent of the nautical mile, which is up to 12 nautical miles from the baseline. We call it as territorial waters, wherein the territorial state or the coastal state have the jurisdiction to decide the dispute. Up to 24 nautical miles from the baseline, it is called contiguous zone, where the rights of the territorial state is restricted. Thereafter, up to 200 nautical miles, it is called exclusive economic zone, where again the rights are considerably narrowed down. And then you have the high seas, where the rights of the territorial state is nil. I say that shipping is almost like a matrimonial relation. Imagine a situation where an American-born boy of Mexican migrant parents wants to marry a German girl of Polish origin. They want to conduct their destination wedding in UK and probably wants to settle down in Italy and then wants to have a surrogate child from India. If they fall out of love, which would be the country and the court where their matrimonial issues can be taken up? Confused, right? This is exactly the reason why some marriages still survive, because they have not been able to decide on the question of jurisdiction. Now take the issue of shipping. Supposing you have an American ship owner with a ship whose class is registered in UK, chartered by probably a Belgian company, traveling from Brazil to India, and in the course of its voyage, runs into multiple jurisdictions and therefore multiple legal disputes. Here, the role of the lawyer comes in, because the easiest thing that any lawyer can take in is to say that the ship is beyond the territorial jurisdiction of the court if the case comes up. Now, I distinctly remember some of the matters where, you know, I was also involved very recently in one matter where there was a carriage of hazardous cargo by a ship which was traveling between two foreign ports and called the coastal port, near the coastal port, and the port authorities and the state government was taking a lot of action trying to remove the ship out of its boundaries. You can see the ship right there, but then the argument was, master was smart, he successfully anchored it just outside the territorial waters, and so we won the case, the court could not do much about it. Then you have another case, which I remember, I'm sure you may have heard about, MV Enrica Lexi, the Italian commercial tanker, which was carrying maritime security guards, and for whose gunshots, two fishermen in Kerala succumbed to death. Here, the ship was actually outside the territorial waters in the contiguous zone, but applying a test that the effect of the gunshot, which is death, occurred and had an effect in the territorial jurisdiction of the Kerala state, the courts in Kerala assumed jurisdiction. So territorial jurisdiction becomes a nail area where a lot of interpretation is done, a lot of admiralty interpretation is done, and there is a scope for a lot of imagination, creativity, and interpretation. Then I remember another case of MV Seaman Guard, Ohio. It's actually a very interesting case. Again, having maritime security guards on board a logistical platform, which is a vessel, which was traveling from place A to B to foreign ports, but happened to be anchored off Tuticorin. This time the master was intelligent, he tried to anchor it outside the territorial waters, but the act of God decided it differently. Though the ship was initially anchored with arms and the security men on board outside, the weather conditions were so bad then that the anchor dragged and the vessel was brought inside the territorial waters. The moment she enters inside the territorial waters, you are subject to the domestic laws of this country. So the state police had to initiate action. Lot of drama that followed after that. Of course, we successfully quashed all the charges and the 34-member crew of different nationalities were sent back to their homes. But the shipowner never came here to fight the litigation, and the ship, along with the arms, are still in the Indian territory. So we have a number of cases like this, where the question of territorial jurisdiction has been sometimes erratically applied also without any uniform pattern. Now, I would also say that law, to some extent, is like your girlfriend. You have to pamper till the girlfriend becomes your wife. Unless you address her specifically, it is very difficult to get a benefit out of that. I distinctly remember one case where a ship was grounded in coastal waters. You can right see there is a ship grounded, sitting on the rock, in the water. But the act that has been invoked by the state was the Water Pollution Prevention and Control Act, wherein we had a specific provision that the water can be called as sea only if there is a notification to that effect. So unless you call it as water, it cannot be water for the purpose of law. So the law interprets things differently. Fortunately for the owner in that case, the particular water where the ship was grounded was not water within the definition of the law that was invoked. That being so, even if you see it is water, water everywhere, but it is not water for the purpose of law. So we had innumerable situations like this, and this is what prompted me to float a venture called Ozone Legal, where I thought, as an IT-enabled platform, I could bring in all the different stakeholders, because you have multiple stakeholders in shipping cases, to come together to a platform where they could discuss their ideas, problems, issues, whether it be technical, commercial, design-related, environmental, or legal, and then come into an amicable resolution without the hitchbacks of territorial issues or legal technicalities. I should say that of now, green shipping is a very, very important concept. Our seas will have to be protected. Our water will have to be protected. You know, water is the elixir of life. Sometimes I feel that our planet is three-fourths water. So even the word planet Earth is a misnomer. It is not planet Earth, it is planet water. And it is our duty, each and every one of us, to ensure that wherever be the forum, whatever be the opportunity given, whether it be the public awareness programs, these TED Talks, or with legal seminars, fighting disputes, technical issues, design related, we should ensure that all is done to save our planet water, so that generations of lovers can still stand on the bow of ships and see how the Pacific embraces the Atlantic. Thank you so much.